today's lecture, we are going to review combinational circuit design. I assume that you studied both what these combinational circuits are and how do you design combinational circuits using gates. The idea would be to do a quick review of the design techniques. Let me first start by defining what combinational circuits are. So the function which relates inputs to outputs. So of course the inputs could be multiple inputs and outputs could also be one or more outputs. The important thing is the present output is a function of present inputs only. So this is how they differ from sequential circuits, which we will discuss later on, where the present outputs are a function of not only the present inputs but also past inputs. Of course, this is not to say that there is an instantaneous relationship, because as we will see, there are delays associated with the circuits, and these delays, which typically are referred to as propagation delays, when the inputs change, the outputs will change after a certain period of time. But primarily, any set of inputs, any combination of inputs would correspond to a unique output, and that's how this function relates the input set to the output set. We typically represent these functions as Boolean functions. And when we talk of Boolean functions, we have to talk of operators, or the operations by which we can combine these inputs or form expressions using these inputs. So some of the operations, AND, OR, NOT, NAND, NOR, exclusive OR. So these operations, we also have symbols for showing the implementation of these operations. So for example, the AND operation is shown with this particular symbol, where we represent C to be A and B. In sometimes some notation, this is also expressed as A and B. So with this we associate, typically with each one of them we associate a truth table. The truth table corresponds to when I take this inputs A, B and talk of the output. I had to talk in terms of all the input combinations. There are four input combinations corresponding to these inputs, and we have the corresponding outputs. The outputs are for 0, 0, the output is 0, 0, 0 and 1. So that's the implication of an, which is referred to this as an AND gate, and this as an AND operation between two input variables B, A and B. So similarly, we have a truth table for each one of these operations. In this case, all these AND, OR, NAND, NOR, exclusive OR, these are all binary operations. They take two inputs, except NOT, which is a unary operation. It has only one input and one output. An important thing about this is there is a unique truth table. Given the set of inputs, we have an output, and that relationship that we have defined it as a truth table, we can associate one truth table to each one of these operations. Let's talk of how many such operations can be formed given the number of inputs. Let's go back and see this. So if you have, talking of a gate, let us say this is a gate which has two inputs and one output. So the problem that we are looking at is how many different gates we can have with two inputs and two outputs. If we form a truth table, we know that 2 raised to the power 2, that is, there are 4 rows in the truth table corresponding to this particular gate. And each of these 4 rows, 4 entries that you can have, can be 0 or 1. That means basically we can have 2 raised to the power 2 raised to the power 2 different operations of two input variables. Similarly, if we talk in terms of n input variables, n input functions, the number of n input functions that you can have would be 2^2n. Because 2^n is the number of rows, and each of the row you have an output entry. So I'm talking of n inputs and one output. And we have n inputs and one output. We have 2^n rows. Each of these output entries could be 0 or 1. And so the total number of such combinations. So even if two truth tables differ in one entry, they correspond to different functions. And that's how we can get 2^2n functions of n inputs. Of course, not all these functions are of much interest. For example, an output entry where all of them is 0 or all of them is 1 may not be of very much interest to us, because this particular function is 0 irrespective of what the inputs are, or the output is 1 irrespective of what the inputs are. Okay, so they are just constant input and constant output. But then they also define a different function than the other functions. Then we have a notion of universal gate set. Okay, a universal gate set, that is, once we have these functions, we can implement these functions, we can see that we can transform these functions of one operation or into functions of other operations. A universal gate set corresponds to a set of gates which can implement any Boolean function. And we have some very interesting sets. Of course, as we can see, that the set AND, OR, and NOT. This is a universal set. But we also have NAND itself to be a universal set, or NOR itself to be a universal set. The implication is that I can take any Boolean function and convert it into a function of NANDs, or I can convert it into a function of NORs. So these gates by themselves, so if you have larger number of these gates, you can implement any combinational logic. We will see this in a moment when we talk of some operations on transformations that can be performed on functions.
AND and NOT is also universal.
AND and NOT together will correspond to an AND. So you can obviously have AND and NOT to be a universal function. Okay. So once you can implement an AND or an OR, then you can implement. Okay, then there is a notion of canonical representation. A canonical representation corresponds to the fact that what we are interested in is there a, if we take a function, is there a unique representation of such a function? And we have two canonical representations for functions. We have sum of min terms and product of max terms. We will see both of them in a moment, but min terms, let us first define what min terms are. Again, we start from, let us say we talk of A, B, C, D, Y. Let's say this is a four-variable function. There is a certain combination of the input. So how many such combinations are there? There are 16 such input combinations, because I have four input variables and they can be 0, 1. Each one of them can be 0 or 1. And so what we have is, if we take one particular combination, then let's say A is 0, B is 1, C is 1, and D is 0. This I can represent as A complement, B, C, D complement. So this is corresponds to, if A is 0, A complement corresponds to 1, B is 1, B corresponds to 1, C corresponds to 1, D is 0, D complement corresponds to 1. So this particular min term, the reason it is called a min term is, it just corresponds to one combination of inputs. This term is 1, only under this combination. If you change A, B, C or D to be anything other than the zeros or ones, this particular expression will be 0. So this actually corresponds to just one combination. And in such a case, we refer to this as a min term. because it does not cover any other combination other than this particular combination. And once I order the variables, I assign a weight. I assign a weight of A to be a weight of 2 raised power 3, 2 raised power 2, 2 raised power 1, 2 raised power 0. This is, of course, an arbitrary order. You could have assigned it in any other manner. But as far as it's clear that what order you have assigned, I can say that this corresponds to 0 plus 4 plus 2 plus 0. So this particular term, which is 0, 1, 1, 0, I can say corresponds to a minterm 6. So this is a way of representing minterms. So when I take a function, a canonical representation of a function could be represented as, I can break it down into what are the input combinations for which the output is 1, and I can represent it as sum of those minterms. So I can take any function, and let us say an example of this could be that function of A, B, C, and D. I can say where each one of them corresponds to a minterm, and typically I will say small m 0, 2, 4, 9, 11. These are the minterms. In a similar manner, I also have a notion of a max term. A max term is the other way. That is, if I take, let's say if I start from the truth table. So let's say I have AB. And now, let me start from a four variable function. It will be more interesting to see for a four variable function. Let me start with the Kornaugh map rather than the truth table. So here, basically, if you talk of a four variable function, I would be should be able to represent this four variable function as 16 minterms. So the 16 minterms, I had to arrange it in a certain manner. And in case of a Kornaugh map, I arrange it in a certain order. Later we will see that why this order is chosen, but for a moment, let me arrange it in a... So I have this 16 entries, and now this 16 entries, if I look at any particular entry, 0, 0, 0, 0, this entry corresponds to A being 0, B being 0, C being 0, D being 0. Similarly, 0, 1, 1, 1, this entry corresponds to the particular combination. So if I put a 1 at any particular place, I know that that particular minterm is present. So a set of 1s over here can be represented as, let us say if I have a 1 here, 1 here, and 1 here, I can represent this function to be A, B, C, D in a, is a sum of minterms. So this is 0. This one is 0, 1, 1, 1. I'm assigning a weight of 2 raised power 3 here, 2 raised power 2, 2 raised power 1, and 2 raised power 0. So this corresponds to 7. I'm just taking its equivalent decimal. And 1, 1, 0, 0 corresponds to 12. Okay, so I can represent a function. So these two representations are equivalent. So this is in terms of the minterms. But if I consider, so here I'm talking of sum of minterms. If I consider a function, if I look, try to look at the zeros over here, if I say this is a zero, I can look at a zero entry over here in terms of what are called max terms. What is a max term? So this particular zero entry and all other ones, so what I'm interested in is representing zero and let me 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. This I can represent it as a max term. What is a max term? I replace, so in this case, I replace this 0 by A plus B plus C plus D prime. So this corresponds to, this particular corresponds to A plus B plus C plus D prime. The implication is, if you consider the function just A, A is the function which is 1 whenever A is 1. B is a function which is 1 whenever B is 1. So A plus B is going to be 1 for all these cases. C is 1 whenever C is 1. And D prime is 1 when D is 0. So if you look at this, this essentially eliminates everything else other than this particular entry. It covers everything else other than this particular 0. And such a thing is called a max term, because this is a term which is 1 for all other cases other than this. Of course, the conversion process, you have to be careful. I am taking wherever this, for this particular entry A to be 0, I am taking A and not, unlike the other case, not the A complement. So if I have a few zeros like that in my, so this is actually nothing but a truth table written in a slightly different manner. In a truth table, I would have written A, B, C, D, and written 16 rows, and here I am writing the truth table in a manner, rearranging them in a slightly different table. So I can represent this function as a product of max terms. So if I have function A, B, C, D, I can say it is product of some max terms, 0, 4, whatever, 12, 15. The implication of this is that there are only 4 zeros in, if I take the truth table of this particular function, and rest of them, and these 4 zeros would correspond to this. And we will come back to this, how do we can simplify functions represented as in this manner. The reason they are called canonical representation is that the representation of the function is unique. That is, if I have a function which is equivalent to this, and if I choose the same order for the variables, that's important. I cannot have, if I choose a different order, obviously these terms will change. Yeah, so the reason we call this as canonical representation is that as long as we have an identical truth table, an identical function, and if I represented this either in this manner or in this manner, the representation itself will be unique. That is, there will be only one way, so it's easy to check whether the two functions are equivalent or not. Now let's talk about how do we simplify such functions. So the Kornaugh map we already introduced when we are talking of max terms. Let's get into using this Kornaugh map for simplification. There's something about the Kornaugh map. So I have taken a function which is a 4-variable function. A 4-variable function could have up to 16 min terms. This particular 4-variable function has 7 min terms, which are 1. They should be min terms. Okay. And I have written them into a table of this type. So 0, 0, 0 is present, so there is a 1 over here. All the entries which are left blank correspond to zeros in this case, and I don't have to write it. If you want to be very explicit, you can write it. So now what we have over here is 7 ones corresponding to these sevens. So now I want to write a function which is simplification of this, and the order in which these inputs are chosen, for example 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1. The idea of putting 1, 1 next to 0, 1 is that when I look at the two entries which are close to each other, they only differ by only one variable. This corresponds to C prime D, this corresponds to C D, and this corresponds to C D prime. Because of this reason, I can combine. So I can take this and combine all these ones and eliminate some of the terms. Primarily, I use the fact that if I have x plus x complement, I can replace it by 1. That is the simple fact that one tries to use repeatedly. And in this case, if you look at these four terms contain all the combination of A and B, A prime, B prime, A prime, B, AB, and AB prime, with CD to be common. So this particular function would correspond to CD because it will eliminate AB. For this, I can, in this case, I am eliminating one variable because there are only two ones that are included, which are neighboring ones. So the variable that will be eliminated will be B. So this will be C prime, D prime, or if I write it in the same order, it's A prime, C prime, D prime. And now, in this case, I can again eliminate one variable. The variable, so these are also close to each other, though you do not see that in this manner. But if you look at it, this is A prime, B prime, and this is A, B prime. So A can be eliminated. This is the simplified function that you get by eliminating variables which can be eliminated by repeated application of this particular rule. A similar procedure can be followed for Kornaugk maps which are made of the max terms. So if you have the max term 1, 5, 9, 13, 15, so as I said, 1 would correspond to 0 here, 0 here. And the reason that this product terms work is, if you take the product of each one of them, anywhere there is a 0, the resulting function will be a 0 there, because it's a product of all those expressions. And I can apply exactly the same procedure. So this particular function would be, I can take this, and this corresponds to, I can eliminate variables A and B. So this corresponds to C plus D prime. And now I'm going to write it as a product of, not a sum of, so this is a product of sums. And so again, I can take this one. So this one eliminates, so I have this. So this is A prime plus B prime plus, in this case, C will be eliminated. So this is another way of writing the function. So in this case, it is a product of sums. So that's the Kornaugk map, application of Kornaugk map for simplification of functions. We will talk about the extension of this for functions where part of the inputs are don't care. We will talk about that later. Now let's talk about the duality principle. In case of Boolean functions, AND and OR are dual in the sense that we replace the following and any equality will hold. What are we replacing? We replace AND by OR and vice versa. Wherever an AND appears, you replace it by OR. Wherever OR appears, you replace it by AND. Similarly, you replace 0 by 1 and vice versa. So wherever there is a 0, you replace, put 1 and 1. And you do this, apply these to uniformly in an expression, in any equality, and the equality will hold. So this is the duality principle, and sometimes, very often, this can be used for converting expressions or converting, making some transformations from AND to OR or vice versa. A very interesting law, which again is used for making transformations, is what called De Morgan's laws. What they do is they relate and to ors and or to ands. And what we have is A plus B complement is nothing but A complement B complement. Of course, to prove such a De Morgan law, one way is to prove it exhaustively. We can take all combinations of A and B. So there are just four combinations of A and B. We can evaluate both these expressions and make sure that all the entries are the same. The only way two functions are equivalent is in the truth table, all the entries should be same. Similarly, so A and B complement of that, there is NAND of A and B, is nothing but A complement plus B complement. So what this allows us to do is, to if you want to transform, so this is a very interesting application of this is, let us say you have an expression, and you want to convert this expression into all to be ors only. I can convert it in this manner. Because a complement of the complement is same as the expression itself. So now I can apply the De Morgan's law within this. And so I have now have a function. So if I had to implement this function using just NOR gates, I can implement this just using NOR gates. Similarly, if I wanted to take this particular function and I want to implement it only using NAND gates, I could have still done it. I can say A plus and this is nothing but equivalent to I. What I had done is I had taken this particular complement and opened this as two expressions, and this is A complement of this dot and BCD complement. And I can implement this again using NAND gates. So it is possible to make this starting from such an expression. I have transformed it just as a function of course, ors and nots I change interchangeably because you can always invert an OR gate to get an OR gate. Similarly, I can implement it using just NAND gates. So De Morgan's laws are used extensively for making this transformation. We talked of the simplification. Along with the simplification, it's important that what is the, when I'm trying to simplify, what is the objective of such a simplification? And this is related to reducing the cost or the area of the design. In case of combinational logic, a very simple measure of the cost or the area is the number of literals. That is, if I take an expression in which there are fewer number of literals, I assume that the cost of implementing that is going to be smaller. That's the reason I try to identify in my Kornaugh map min terms which are close to each other. Close to each other means they only differ by one variable. There's one variable which is in true form in one min term and complement form in the other min term. Combine that and eliminate that variable. And I keep on applying this as often as possible. So I have my cost to be reduced. Similarly, I talk of number of levels for time. Let me define this. When you talk of a combinational circuit, so if I have a circuit in this manner, let's say, so there is a, if you consider this, so starting from an input, so these are A, B, C are inputs and Y is an output. If my input A changes, my output Y will change after the delay of this and the delay of this. So whatever is the delay of the AND gate, let us say T AND, and whatever is the delay of this OR gate. So T AND plus T OR is the delay of this circuit. Of course, if you look at when the input C changes, the output Y will change. If it has to change, it will change more quickly because the number of levels, so this is called the number of gate levels. The number of gate levels that are present from any of the input A or B to Y is 2, whereas from C to Y there is only 1. But we always take the critical path. Critical path is the maximum number of levels. And the maximum number of levels in this case for this circuit is 2. From any input to any output. So if I take, so because this is essentially is a summation of all the inputs to output. This of course in, sort of ignores the secondary effect. The secondary effect is the delay of a gate is not independent of number of inputs. For example, if you consider a gate, let's say, which has 4 inputs, and if you consider a gate which has only 2 inputs, so the delay of this gate typically will be larger than the delay of this gate. But this is something, in case of number of levels, we are not considering that. Of course, when we are minimizing, I will try to, I am counting this, because the cost of this, I am counting it as 4, because the number of literals that will be present for this such a gate will be 4. For cost minimization, I consider that this is more expensive than this, but for delay minimization, I am not considering. And that effect is, of course, important, but it is a secondary, like it's smaller effect than the number of levels. So whenever I am trying to minimize, so my minimization objectives are number of literals for cost or area and number of levels for time. Now we come to an interesting type of functions which are called symmetric functions. Let me first define what symmetric functions are. If we consider functions where you change, let's say exchange two variables. If you have an expression consisting of, let's say, 4 variables A, B, C, and D, and if you say that I exchange A for B and B for A in throughout in the function, and if my function does not change, then such a function is supposed to be symmetric around A and B. That is, it doesn't matter. So if you replace A by B and B by A in the whole expression, so then such a function would be symmetric. So such functions are called symmetric functions, and there's also a lot number of applications of functions which are completely symmetric around all the input variables, because those functions we will talk about a little bit about such functions. Let us say you have 4 variable functions A, B, C, D. What is the total number of functions you can form of 4 variables? 2 raised to the power 4. Okay, 2 raised to the power 16, and that is a very large number. That is some 64,000 plus. But how many symmetric functions, let's say I call them to be completely symmetric, how many symmetric functions I can form of 4 variables? That means they are symmetric around all the 4 variables. That means what I am interested in is, first of all, you look at it, if the function is symmetric, then I am only interested in saying that how many of these inputs are 1. The only condition of interest to me is, so I define, let us say Ni is number of I inputs to be 1. So you have N0, N1, N2, N3 and N4. For a 4 variable function, so N0 corresponds to, of course, to only 1 minterm. हमें n0 corresponds to one min term which is 0000. n1 corresponds to four min terms because any of the four variables could be one. n2 corresponds to four c2 min terms. Choose two out of four. n3 corresponds to four c3 min terms. Choose three variables out of four. And n4 again corresponds to only one min term which is ABCD. If this function is completely symmetric, I am only interested in defining what is the output I need in case of n0, n1, n2, n3 and n4. These are the only four, five independent things I can define, which means that I can have only 2 raised to power 5 symmetric functions. Because I can say that my output should be 0 for this, 1 for this, 0 for this, 1 for this, 0 for this. Or I can define my output should be 1 for this, 0. I cannot specify. So within these 4 min terms that corresponds to 1, what are the 4 min terms which corresponds to one of the variables being 1? It's a, b prime, c prime, d prime, a prime, b, c prime, d prime, a prime, b prime, c, d prime, and a prime, b prime, c prime, d. These are the four min terms, which corresponds to one variable being one, and they all correspond to one variable. I should not distinguish, as far as my output is concerned, I should not distinguish between what my output should be for these four min terms. Why? Because otherwise the function will no longer be symmetric. If I say that my output for this should be 1 and output for this should be 0, that means when I replace A by B, my output will change. I exchange A by B and B by A, my output will change. So I should not distinguish between these four min terms. And they are all captured by saying whether for when one variable is 1, whether I want output to be 1 or a 0. When two variables are 1, whether I want output to be 1 or a 0. So I can independently define my output to be, for n0 what my output should be, n1 what should be, n2, n3, n4. That means I have 5 different things to define. So I have to define my output in terms of this 5, and I have 2 raised to power 5 such combinations possible, and so the total number of 4 variable symmetric functions is, so for n variables the total number of symmetric functions will be 2 raised to power n plus 1 rather than 2 raised to power. Parity is a one case of an interesting example of a symmetric function, because what happens is in case of the parity, we are only interested in counting. Let us say we are finding out whether odd number of variables are 1 or not, and defining the parity to be 1 if odd number of variables are 1. Okay, so that means in the previous case, if it is a 4 variable case, so odd number of 1s is n1 correspond to 1 being one of the variables being 1, and n3 corresponding to 3 of the variables being 1. My function is defined by, for n1 and n3 I should have output should be 1. Okay, so that is an example of a parity function. Okay, we will stop here. We will continue with this.